Hi, I'm Eric Olson. Stay with us here. We've got a great show for you on Q. We're going to take the whole half hour and talk about the new proposed referendum coming up for a vote in the Austin Public Schools. Our guest will be Superintendent Joey Page for the entire show to answer questions about that referendum coming up. So stay with us on Q.
Local ideas that matter to you, sharing our region's unique point of view, telling the stories that you never knew, on Q, on Q, on Q.
This year, the Austin Public School System is asking voters to approve an increase in funding when they go to the ballot on November the 8th. It would be an increase from the district's current operating referendum, but if voters turn down the new referendum, the district says it will have to deal with a major deficit and other fallout. Joining us now to talk more about the details of this referendum question is Dr. Joey Page, the superintendent of Austin Public Schools. Dr. Page, welcome to On Cue.
Thank you very much for having me.
Say, before we get going, just a bit of housekeeping. Why is it that school districts in Minnesota have to go to all the voters, you know, when you're in other governmental, you know, city council or county, just among themselves, they will pass a levy. Seldom does it go to a vote, but you see it in school districts. Is that because other funding that you receive isn't keeping up?
Yeah, you know, I think a way to look at that is, you know, the state of Minnesota provides the majority of funding for our local schools, but the most for most districts, this level of support isn't enough to cover the cost for our students and their services and educational programming. And that's why you see in the state of Minnesota, about 70% of school districts across the state rely on funding from local operating levies to help bridge that gap.
Okay. And what is an operating levy and how does it work? Can you just kind of break it down into plain English for us?
Yeah. Well, there's two forms of that. What we have, an operating levy really helps fund the district's operating budget, which pays for the day-to-day functions and operations of the district. And so what does that include? We have our salaries for our staff, our educational supplies, program costs, utilities, and anything with routine maintenance. And that's different from a bond where you're looking to build something. So what we like to say and help people with this is our levies are for learning and our bonds are for building.
Okay. And this is a levy, so it's for learning.
That is correct.
Okay. Talk a little bit about what this entails coming up for voters in November. What is the program?
Yeah, so you know, to back up a little bit from that is what we've discussed too is, you know, this is a plan to invest in our growing district, and the need here that we outlined is basically stated as our funding for schools has not kept up with inflation in Minnesota for over a decade. And what we're looking at for the Austin Public Schools is to propose this levy for the community, the citizens of the school district, to make a determination on what they want to support from the school district. And so what we've looked at doing here, starting on our process, is to get input from the community on what our tax tolerance is, because our Austin Public Schools has exhausted all the funding options.
Is this a similar situation that all school districts would be in, since you know, funding comes from most of it from the state?
Yes, yeah, we're all funded the same, you know, as far as we get our from the state where our funding comes from. Referendums do is really allow the taxpayers, the community, to take matters that have been in their own hands.
And what is the funding situation compared with other school districts in the area, at, you know, presently? And if voters approve it, will we be sort of on par with the others?
Yeah. So We currently, our voter approved operating levy that we have is $42.70 per pupil. And so what we've shared in publications, and we have a website on accelerateaustin.org that provides information on the regional average of referendum value. So you could go see what Austin looks like compared to our other regional schools. And then you can also see where that current value is. But if this is favorable, what the referendum value would be in comparison to other regional schools. And so if this is favorable, we'll be taking a great step forward with our other school districts.
Well, yeah, it looks like on the chart I saw, we're at the bottom or something like that. What does that say?
Correct. Yeah. So if you look with the graphic here that we've provided from the state of Minnesota, you'll see the regional average. You'll see where Minnesota is at their current rate. And then you can do the comparison for other school districts in the region. We've also indicated on the bar graph then too, is if what the new referendum value would be if this is successful.
So when you say learning, folks would want to know what dollars, is it salaries only that would increase, or what, when you say learning, that's what this is levy is for, what kinds of right on the ground, real world things does that mean?
Yeah. So what we're talking about with the levies, we're talking about our day-to-day expenses like instructional staff, our programs, educational supplies, utilities. So those are the day-to-day expenses of our district, and that's what this operating levy would be in supporting.
So it's not the pay of the teachers?
Nope, that is an operating expense. So our operating expense includes our salary and benefits for employees.
Oh, okay. So how long of a period of time is this in effect for?
Yeah. So if approved, the operating levy increase for our district would be in place for a 10-year period. And then at which point the voters would need to reauthorize the operating levy for it to continue.
Is that some kind of statute or something that it can only be 10 years or what?
Yeah, you can have a shorter period, but you cannot extend past that. That has to be put back to the voters to either reauthorize or increase it or have it phase out.
I don't remember if it was the last election, but there was one recently that I don't think passed. Is this the same thing?
Yes, we've had two elections in the last couple of years. One was a bonding project for our early childhood center and expansion and removing into a new area on Woodson. That was not successful. And then prior to that, there was an operating levy out for the public too, and that was also not successful.
Hmm. And are there any other, let's see, what did you say, sunsetted levy? Are there any in place now, any previous referenda that are in effect yet, or are they all sunsetted?
Yep. So we currently have the referendum voter approved levy at $42.70. So that will be sunsetting in pay 24. So we have another year with that. And the district will have to make a determination at some point to either reauthorize that, revoke or replace it. But that's not what this operating levy is about.
Okay, so it's a separate entity. It's not to keep that one going.
Yep, that is separate.
Okay, and if that one sunsets, then does that also then have to go before all the voters?
Correct, yep, to get approval for that.
All right, so what do we see when folks go and decide on this? I know it's hard to go with a negative on this, but what is there, if it doesn't pass, what will there be tangible programs that we just can't offer to our students?
Yeah, and I think the question there, Eric, you know, is why is this issue on the ballot? What we're facing as a school district is a $3 million budget deficit next year. And without an increase in revenue and substantial reductions in our staffing, which includes the class sizes and student programming, that's why we have this out for the public to determine. We're using our one-time COVID funding that is going away in 24. And so we're proposing this operating levy to help protect our staffing levels, our class sizes, student programs, and activities.
What are the top few drivers of the that's causing the deficit? Are there some big tickets at the top that you can talk about that will be problematic going forward?
Yeah, I think, you know, the costs of our operations continues to rise. You know, our school district, like our families and community members and their lives, also have to work with inflation increases. And so that has been impactful for us. Our costs continue to rise. They go exceed what we are receiving funding from the state. And so that's why we have this question before the citizens.
So it's just like paper costs more, media software costs more, computers cost more, all of those things?
Absolutely. Our benefits and salaries rise. Our costs in operations and things we talked about or mentioned as far as utilities costs, just the day-to-day expenses for supplies, that continues to increase as well.
So in action or inaction, whatever, however you want to call it, at the state legislature, like last session, that was bonding bill that didn't get through. I mean, if they'd have passed a bunch of stuff, would we not be talking about this, or doesn't it really matter what happens at the state level?
Well, it really is important as far as what happens at the state level. But I think one of the things we have to be really clear on too is we have different kind of funds, and each fund that we have in a school district has different operations with it. Or different in how it can be spent. So we have two major funds. We have our operating funds, which this is about, the referendum question. We also have capital funds. Again, the operating funds is going to provide most of the funds we use for our day-to-day operations, employee salaries, benefits, electricity, materials, and supplies for the classrooms and things like that. Our capital funds, and you mentioned where we were with bonding, those would be things like for district buildings, furniture, equipment, and help us pay debt. Okay. So it's really, really important what the legislature does and how it impacts schools.
Very interesting. We're having a great talk here with the superintendent of Austin Public Schools, Dr. Joey Page, here on Cue with the referendum question coming up. This is Accelerate Austin. And so what is accelerating? Are there more students? Is the population going up, or the needs of these individual students, they need more help? What is accelerating?
Yeah, it's an important term. You know, last year we spent the entire year working on our new strategic plan that was coming to an end. And so one of the things that we looked at through our community engagement process is to determine what is the desired daily experience that our students, our families and caregivers and staff expect each and every day. With that work, we looked a long time at what our mission is as a school district and our vision. And one of the things where we were at as we continue to come out of the last couple of years with the pandemic is we really did focus on that word accelerate. And what we're talking about and what this means for us is, you know, the movement the cadence and the pace of our school district and change needs to be faster. We have to move faster in education. Our kids require that as we prepare them for life outside of the high school, whether that's right into career or right into college. And we wanted to make sure that we had that as a central focus point for our new strategic plan on accelerating everything that we do here in Austin for better student outcomes.
And that's directly tied to the referendum, or that's separate? That's a separate
initiative? Right. Yeah. Our website for referendum information, we're calling it accelerateaustin.org. And it's also part of our mission to accelerate.
Okay. And I know you've started a new online high school. Is that part of this program? And does the referendum question, does anything impact that operation?
Yeah, we have our Austin Online Academy being led by Jessica Cabine as the principal. That is a new feature for our school district. We're in our second year with that. And so, you know, that is an operating expense for the district. We're using our one-time COVID funds to help launch that program. And we will be looking at, you know, how its enrollment looks and how it's growing for the future.
And it, will the referendum impact that, whether it goes, whether it's approved or disapproved?
Yeah, so right now we're using our COVID funding to help launch our online academy. And so as we determine, you know, the viability of that program and what our enrollment looks like, that becomes, you know, part of our operations. And it's, you know, proving to be an option that families want. Really interesting, you know, to think of a brick and mortar organization like we have been, and to think that we have to be, you know, thinking about an online option for families is, it's one of the outcomes of the last couple of years of being in distance learning and hybrid learning, that this is something that our families are interested in, and a lot of districts are getting involved with that. And so we have to remain competitive for our students and for what families want for an educational opportunity for their kids.
So that's very interesting that it seems like something positive, I don't want to really say came out of it, but the technology we've all been using, just like doing this interview on Zoom, has really accelerated to the point where it might end up being a net positive for students.
Yeah. Yeah, we, you know, we had students that were successful with it. And as I said before, you know, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, to think of, you know, what we thought of school districts and having to, you know, be have their foot in the an online learning environment to the level that it is right now. And it is really exciting and interesting to see on how fast we've evolved.
Yeah, it's not for everyone. I don't think it would have been for me as a youth, because I really needed that interpersonal. Yep. And as I understand it, a lot of these students on the online are the high achievers. They're above the line. I mean, they are you have to be self-driven to be doing it, not really on your own, I don't want to say, but independently.
Yeah, you know, it's open to all of our 9-12 students for that. And people, you know, all of our kids the last few years have had a go of it, right? Depending where they were with their grade level or what school districts are in as they navigated through COVID and online learning. But we're definitely see as we get removed from that time period to where we are now that there is interest in it. And we have a, you know, a healthy enrollment in it right now.
Back to the levy question, before it gets to voters, did your Board of Education have to approve it or somehow authorize it or say, we're for this?
Correct. Yep. That's how the process works. So it's up to the board to make the determination on calling the election. You know, and some information about that I've had questions on is when we I've done presentations to the community or groups or just questions individually. It's like, how did we come up with this number? You know, why is it, you know, why is the number the way it is? So what we did prior to the board calling the election is we did a community survey using a professional organization, Baker Tilly, to gauge tax tolerance in the community. And so what that process yielded was, you know, if we look at the average house in Austin of $170,000, the tax tolerance information that came back in the survey was about $12 a month that people felt comfortable with and had the highest level of support. And so we use that information to share that with the board to get, you know, this is what the dollar amount would yield for that. And we thought it was very important to listen what people told us. I've had some questions on, it's like, well, you know, if this is favorable, look where we are, you know, should we have asked for more? And the data didn't support that. And so I think we wanted to not be disingenuous to what people told us. And the board did a very good job of reviewing that and listening to that and to determine, you know, what that referendum value would be for this particular levy.
I think that's an important point, at least for me, to understand that it's not just administrators saying, here's what we need. This went through elected, through the board, you know, who are elected to, and they have approved this idea.
Correct.
But they can't just approve it on their own, even though they're elected officials.
Yeah, this is a, yep, this is the voter approved referendum. Yes.
And throw out that, that web address. Can you get at it just from the regular school district page?
Yes, you certainly can. The referendum address is accelerateaustin.org. If and so that's what will take you right there. But if you go to austin.k12.mn.us, which is the district homepage, you will see a button right at the top of the page that says Accelerate Austin, and that'll take you right to the referendum site.
What is enrollment district wide? What are you prognosticating in the future years?
Yeah, great question. So last year, what we've been on a regular cycle of doing enrollment studies and projections, and last year was no different. We actually moved it up a year just because of the 2 years with COVID and wanting to get our hands on some fresh data. So we worked with a demographer to do an enrollment study for the school district. And what we saw, or what's been shared back and in our planning over the next 10 years, is really unique. You know, with we are expected to grow over the next 10 years anywhere from, you know, 13 to 18%. We have a rapidly growing student population. And which is increasing at a time when many of our rural school districts are facing declines in enrollment. And so that's exciting, I think, for the community of Austin, for our school district to be in a growing district. And so that, I think, is one of the things that's really important about this referendum, is that we want to, you know, manage those resources and help our staff and our programs be here when those kids come.
And it's always a guessing game, I'm sure, despite all the best efforts, because you don't know, you know, we're a fluid society and people move, you know, you don't know if that little one in K is going to be there in 12.
That's right. There's a, you know, this goes back to an earlier question too. We talk about online schooling and you know, the options for families, you know, for open enrollment is real in choices for families with that. And so, yeah, it is a very delicate game to navigate and make predictions on. But we use all the available tools and you know, predicting analytics to help us, you know, plan budgets that will be in alignment to what our policies are.
So give me the top three points again on your vision with Accelerate Austin, why it's a positive thing that folks really ought to consider.
Right. Well, I think first and foremost is our district is committed to our mission of inspiring, empowering, and accelerating student learning now and in the future. And this includes a couple things. One is using our resources effectively and attracting our students and keeping more of our students in our district. It also means preparing for our enrollment growth that I talked about. But also, you know, launching in our strategic plan that is really, I think, going to propel our district into the next level of success and preparation for students as we want them and prepare them to make a difference in the world.
Well, I appreciate the time you've given us, Dr. Page. It's been a very interesting discussion. Thank you and for joining us, and good luck in your mission here with educating our young people.
Thank you very much for having me.
Dr. Joey Page, Superintendent of Austin Public Schools. That'll do it for this edition of On Cue. I'm Eric Olson. Thanks for watching.